So, Wayte Discipuli, today I'm going to be giving a lecture on the story of Aeneas and his family according to Livy. This is the first of many lectures that we'll be giving that either I or Magister will be giving. So, when you go through this, please just take some notes on each slide as I go. Remember, you can always stop the presentation if need be if you're missing anything. All right, so here we go. Let's talk about Aeneas and Roman history. All right, so the Romans trace all their history back to the Trojan War that happened supposedly around 1200 BCE. And of course, this war started with Helen being abducted by a Trojan prince, Paris, taken to the city, and then a war was waged for 10 years by the Greeks against the Trojans to get her back. And during this war, there was two people who really wanted to give Helen back, according to Livy, Aeneas and another Trojan leader named Antenor. And so they wanted to give her back. And because of that and other connections, Livy says, they were allowed to leave Troy after the war unmolested. So this is now, if you read Virgil, it has a different thing. There was an epic escape by Aeneas, but according to epic escape of Aeneas, and he was able to get out and save his, save his family mostly, and also, and then save a group of Trojans. But according to Livy, it was more like a deal because of how he tried to get Helen back to the Greeks. Now, Antenor escaped, and he and his followers sailed west and landed in northern Italy on the east coast, so up where Venice and Padua is today. He joined forces with a local group called the Aneti and drove out another group called the Ugani from a region between the Alps and the Adriatic. And then the populations mixed, and the mixture of these populations are now called the Venetians. So the people in that area near Padua and Venice trace their ancestors back to Troy. And Padua is if you look up here, is up right here, and it's a city and a commune in northern Italy, and even today they still claim to be the oldest city in northern Italy. And so there we go. So pretty cool. So these Trojans here, now we're going to talk about Aeneas, and he's going to go to a different region of Italy. So Aeneas's travels, this is the traditional travels outlined by the Aeneid on this map, where he sails to Thrace, to Macedonia, comes to Crete, goes here, and then goes to Carthage. Now, according to Livy's accounts, he does not go to Carthage. So he first, according to Livy, he stops in Macedonia, which is northern Greece up here. Then he goes to Sicily over here, and then to Laurentium. He does not go to Carthage. He goes up straight to Laurentium, which is a region that we would call Latium or Latium today. And it's interesting that in Book 4 of Virgil's Aeneid, which is the epic of Rome, it's similar to the Iliad or the Odyssey, but written in Latin for a Roman audience. Virgil spends like a whole book, so a good 1/12 of his narrative about this relationship between, a little bit actually even more than that, about the relationship between Aeneas and Dido, who's the queen of Carthage. But Livy does not mention this at all, which is interesting. Here is where the area that he came to. This is central, the Tiber's right up here, Rome's here, and this is the area that Aeneas supposedly landed. Now, the people they ran into were the Latins. And they, when the Trojans came there, they were the ones who were living there. And they were not so happy to see them. They were led by a king named King Latinus. There's two stories about what has happened, and you should be familiar about these two stories. In the first story, the Trojans defeat the Latins in a battle, and Latinus's daughter was given to Aeneas as part of a peace treaty. Or in the second story, before the battle, there was a parley where they came and had a conference before the battle. King Latinus asked Aeneas who he was and where he's from and what's happened. And Aeneas, of course, said, "I am Aeneas, son of Venus. We're from Troy. We traveled across the Mediterranean, coming here, fated by the gods, blah, blah, blah. And Aeneas was, but Latinus was so impressed by Aeneas's noble bearing that he decided to go ahead and offer his daughter in marriage to Aeneas and make a peace treaty. So which story is true? All right. The Trojans, once they got there, found a place for a permanent settlement, and they called it Livinia. It's named after Aeneas' wife, Livinia. Aeneas and Livinia had a son, Ascanius, later known as Iulus. Now, this is important because the Iulus name, it traces to the Julian family. So Julius Caesar, Augustus, and those group, that family, all say that they are descendants of Aeneas and Livinia. Now, once the Trojans settled there, other Italians were not so pleased that the Trojans were there. So the Trojans and the Latins became involved in the war with Turnus, prince of the Rutuli. And this is talked about extensively in Virgil's Aeneid. In Livy, it's not as so extensive. The war starts, both Livy and Virgil agree that the war starts because Lavinia was promised to marry Turnus. But instead, she married Aeneas. In the Trojans and the Latins, however, defeat the Rutuli, but King Latinus was killed in the war. Now, after this, Aeneas decided to go ahead and get rid of the Trojan name and adopted the native name of Latins for the Trojans to strengthen the bond between the two people. They didn't call themselves Trojan anymore, but they said, we're all Latins together. Now, they also had another group that was causing problems. Turnus joins forces with King Mezentius of Etruria. And the Etruscans were a group north of Latium. And there, these Etruscan people were afraid that the Latin/Trojans would cause problems. The Latins were victorious, however. And the defeat of the Etruscans was the last major accomplishment of Aeneas. He lived for about 3 years after he arrived, and then he died, but was buried either in or near a river and was called Jupiter Ignignes, the local Jupiter. Now let's talk about Ascanius a little bit. Now Ascanius, the son of Aeneas, was still underage. And Lavinia, his mother, ruled the Latins until Ascanius was of age to become ruler. Now, there's a little confusion here, and Livy addresses this as well, is there's two stories about who Ascanius' mother was. In the Aeneid, Creusa, Aeneas' wife, who died in the sack of Troy, was considered the mother of Ascanius. And then Livy also says there's one story that Ascanius was the mother of Aeneas' dead wife, who died in Troy. And then other stories say that Lavinia, the daughter of King Latinus, was the mother of Ascanius, but we just don't know. And then, of course, Iulus is another name for Ascanius. But whatever happened, Ascanius, once he became of age, he decided that he did not want to stay in Lavinia. And so he left the city of Lavinium to his mother or stepmother, and went and decided to found a new city called Alba Longa, the Long White. And then Ascanius' descendants ruled Alba Longa for 4 generations. And there we go. All right. Valete escipuli, lingua latina est vita.